So now I assume that all of you are already very tired, so I will try to be as brief as I can. And the talk that I wanted to share with you, so these are my thoughts related to the first talk, to Ryan's talk, actually. So he has given the concept of this mathematical modeling, and he said that always mathematical model is something irrelevant to reality. So while you are reading these words of acknowledgments that I already announced at the beginning of this workshop, I would like to say that the idea of this talk was to try to connect the theory and the application level.
The left button is next. Okay, this is fine.
So, when we are at theory, when we are doing some mathematics, we are somewhere here. And the practical guys who are doing this engineering, they are somewhere there, at the bottom, very close to applications. So we are trying to build some concept or maybe some like scheme to go, let's say, from down to up, to climb the ladder, and then to go from up to down. Because here, you can get the most general results, you can get the insights, you can get some, you know, quantitative things, how everything is happening. Here, at simulation level, usually you are doing some numerics, and it's not very easy to interpret these numbers, and it's not very easy to get some general concept. What is 1.5? What does it mean? 1.5, 1.6. Why should I care about that? At technical level, it's even more complicated. So when you are trying to do some technical modeling, there might be some negative effects, there may be some difficulties when you are trying to interpret the results of your modeling. But it could be very close to life. So it means that you can try to be as close to your application as you can, but still you can try to get some general knowledge about all these similar things happening. And that's the point why we are trying to connect all these three. And you can see that they intersect, yeah? There is some points of intersection. This here, all the three models are intersecting, yeah? So the technical and simulation and applicational level, we can find some point to validate all the three concepts, all the three models. We need to do some validation here to see that they all coincide at this point. And then we can move further here, or go more to practice, to applicability, to this direction. But we need the starting point. And as a result, we'll get some flexible test bed for all these things to happen. So next one, please. So this is a brief outlook of my talk. So I will try to explain what we are currently doing during our research, what we are currently doing at the theoretical level. Then I will explain what we are doing at simulation level, and some concepts, how can we do it at technical level. And I'll give some examples. So maybe it could be considered as some sort of tutorial for students who are trying to move in our direction, who are working with us. So just to let them, because mostly students are involved in some of the activities and they do not see all this output. So maybe they are doing some simulation, some of them are doing some technical modeling and experimenting with all this, you know, nice technical stuff. But not many of them can see all the picture. So I will try to introduce how the picture looks like. So first I will go into the next slide and introduce what we are usually interested in. Because so some, at least some of the students, some of the audience has just are studying now the queuing theory course, and they did not yet get into these, you know, details. So usually when we are studying some queuing system, we get some serving devices, some services, servers, and then some people or customers who arrive, and we are interested into some performance measures of this system, or in transient state, or usually in stationary state, after a long run that has taken for the system. So after a long time passed, we are looking at some specific characteristics which are mostly related to some applications. Maybe the delay and the latency are related to some networking applications. Maybe the queue is more related to some storage. Maybe throughput is very interesting for the people who are working with high performance computing, let's say. So some blocking probabilities is related to some real world, like, I don't know, parking places or whatever. So mostly these are obtained in stable state. So next one. So I will introduce two very interesting methods to work with these performance characteristics. One of them is the matrix analytic method, and you can see many names here who contributed to this method. Some of them unfortunately passed away already, but still you can see that there is some Western and Eastern schools that are dealing with this. And essentially, we are looking at some special structured Markov chain or structured continuous time Markov chain like here. So the structure means that we have a multidimensional process, but the first dimension is related to some sort of, we usually call it a level. That means that something that can make one step up and one step down. That's the usual case. In most cases, we are looking at it's called a quasi-birth death process, because if you look only at this component, it's a birth death process. So step up means a birth, step down means a death. And the second part is related to some phase. Usually the phase is related to application. It may be, let's say, if we are studying the energy efficiency model of some computer, the state might be at what speed does this computer currently work. So it can reduce the speed. You all have this smartphone in your pockets, yeah? You can see that usually it works at reduced speed to save some energy, yeah? But then when you are trying to Google something, you are surfing the web, you see that the smartphone slightly becomes working faster. So that means that it switches the speed to upper level. So this might be considered like a speed or some other specific state that influences how the system behaves. So the key feature is that the first component is switched only to 1, plus 1 or minus 1. Next one, please. So usually you get this generator matrix. That means that you are looking at this structure, these states are lexicographically ordered, and you are looking, so let's say, coming from this point to this, means a decreasing the first component. Because first component here is 0, 1, 2, 3. We go from 3 to 2, from level 3 to level 2. That means that we usually call it a departure. So in terms of queuing, usually you have the first component like number of customers in the system. And that means that we go from 3 customers in the system to 2 customers in the system. That is the departure. But here we have a matrix. This is not a number, but a matrix, which is related to the second component. So that means that this departure happens, but also the switching of the state may happen. And we get this rates of state switching related to a departure. The same here we have an arrival from 2 to 3. Yeah? So here are the rates of switching the system state related to an arrival. And in this case, we just stay flat. We do not have an arrival or a departure, but still we can experience some switching of the state by some internal reasons. So usually you need some stability condition for that, and there is a good one. If you have these matrices available, this is a good stability condition. It's actually a criterion. In this case, due to the Markov structure, this is a criterion. So if it is satisfied, then the system is stable. If it is not satisfied, the system is unstable. So alpha you can also find. If all these matrices are well defined, you can find alpha. Alpha is a vector of, let's say, stationary states or phases, irrelatively to the level. So we do not care at a high levels, we get this alpha as a probability of being at some specific state or some specific phase. Next one. So, and we are interested in this steady state vector, as usual. But in this case, it is also structured due to this two-dimensional structure inside. So we get this P0, P1, etc. And inside, P0 itself is a vector. It's P01, P0M0, and P11, PA1M, which is related to this two-component structure. That means that this is, let's say, P11 is the probability that there is one customer in the system, and the state of the system is 1. In this case, the state of the system is M, one customer in the system. So the nice point is that this so-called matrix geometric solution, that means that once you find this matrix, R, it connects the probability of being at level N minus 1 to the being at level N. So once you find this matrix, you get O. You need only the starting probability, the zero probability, the probability of being at zero level, and then you compute all these probabilities of stationary states. But it's not easy to obtain this matrix. This matrix is a solution of this matrix equation. All of you know what is the second order equation. Yeah, you can easily solve it. But this is the matrix equation with a matrix unknown. So this is an unknown matrix. These unknown matrices, A0, A1, A2, are known. We know them. But R we have to find. And we cannot even guarantee that solution exists. But in case the system is stable, everything is kind of well defined, the solution does exist, but it's not easy to obtain it. So algebraically, it is not possible. Except some certain cases. So, and with this matrix R, we can define all these nice performance measures, like the number of customers in the system, the min response time, and they are, of course, they are connected in between. You can get this little law. And the mean throughput, and whatever, let's say we can compare it to solution of the well-known MM1 theory. So they look similar. This is rho divided by 1 minus rho. This is something like very similar to that. If we know what is P1, P1 is P0 multiplied by R. So it looks very, very similar. Anyway, so the point is that if you have R, you have everything, and even the performance measures. But how to find it? Next one, please. Usually it's done by some iterative procedure. So that means that at this specific point, you come from theory to numerics, down to numerics. So from theory, you are going to some numerical procedures. You need to do some kind of logarithmic reduction algorithm. So algorithmically, you can find a solution. You find it in numbers, not in general. So it doesn't mean that you can find some sort of general solution, parametric solution. No, you need to do numbering. So the non-explicit solution, that means that only in terms of matrices A0, A1, A2 we obtain a solution, is known for the case where A0 or A2 is of rank 1. That means a very specific theoretical case. Of course, in some cases it could be the case, but still, it is very specific. Or you can go to algebra and try to search the Jordan canonical form of this matrix. And then by defining it, you can have this matrix as a multiplication of this, where D is diagonal matrix that contains the eigenvalues of this matrix. But practically, this means the same, that you still have to go to the numerics, at least to find this D matrix and then to find these vectors, which is not a very easy numerical procedure. Next one, please. So, I will try to show one case, but very briefly. One case that is also interesting for students, I think. So this is some small step ahead. So as I said previously, we knew that the A0 or A2 matrix should be of rank 1 to obtain explicit solutions. But we managed to figure this out, and this is joint work with Professor Garimel Ramamurti, who didn't manage to present this work by Skype because we had some technical problems. Probably we'll have to shift this presentation to this Tuesday session. So So if oil, all of this is available for matrix of size 2x2. It's a very small one. So in this case, it means that you have only two phases at each level. Two phases, but still it might be a matrix of rank 2. That means it's full rank matrix. And the nice point for students is that in this case you can get some very simple knowledge from your school studies or from the early university years, where you can find the solution of this third degree quotient. So do you remember that you can obtain it, yeah? And for the degree 5, it is not even possible in all cases, yeah? But for degree 4 and for degree 3, it is possible to obtain a solution. Moreover, you can do it explicitly. So you don't need to do it in numerics, you can do it explicitly. And in terms of this solution, you can express the R matrix effect. So you only need to find one root of this polynomial. This is a determinantal polynomial of 4th degree, and then from it we obtain the characteristic polynomial of matrix R, and then from it we can actually boil everything down to the linear quotient. Next, please. So this is the solution of this linear quotient, which you get from Cayley-Hamilton theorem, by obtaining this characteristic polynomial of this matrix, because it is a solution of this characteristic polynomial. And then, so only we need to find one root. And one root you can find by this simple formula, it's the biggest one. Yeah? So by trigonometric solution of this third degree quotient. And that means that in fact, you need this simple knowledge from your, let's say, childhood, to obtain a solution of this, from the first side, a very complicated problem. So it's interesting that time to time you get these interconnections inside mathematics. Yeah, very simple things that are connected to more general things, but still you need this to know these simple things. So now we obtain this matrix R in terms of only these A0, A1, A2 matrices and B0, B1, which are, let's say, explicitly defined by this root. That is also explicitly defined. So everything is found now. And this is some sort of algorithm how to do that. And if, of course, in special case, it's the well-known solution for the rank 1 matrix. So obtain purely by resolution rank. Please, next one. So that was about the matrix analytic method. And I will show the example. So the next one is a regenerative method. It is, in case of matrix analytic method, basically we are doing with some sort of map of chain. But in case of regenerative method, it's not the case. So the process might be very complicated, but we need some points of regeneration. So that means that at some points, specific points, the process forgets about the history. But not necessarily at each point. Yeah? So in case of map of chain, you know that if you are at this specific state, you can forget about it. History, or maybe like Professor Krishnamurti said, you need to know two previous states. But still, you can forget about all of the history before. In this case, it might be not the case. You can have very complicated dependent structure inside that doesn't allow you to apply the matrix analytic method. But still, you can get some insight on the performance of the process by defining the regeneration points. And then, if you have this positive recurrence of the process, so it means that time to time it regenerates. Finally, the expected length of this regeneration will be defined. So that means that time to time it comes to this state, it forgets about the history. And by this, by doing so, you can accumulate some quantity which is related to performance, accumulate it, and then at this regeneration points, you do this kind of time averaging like that. So you divide the accumulated quantity divided by time, and then you see that it converges to the real performance of this system. Next one, please. So now we go to the level 2, yeah? So we know that So theoretically, in easier cases, we can do this matrix analytic method. In more complicated cases, we can do this regeneration simulation or whatever. But in what to do with even more general? So if we cannot assume that there are regeneration points, etc. So we can do the simulation. If we know some ideas what the model looks like, how it behaves, we can try to do some simulation. And there is a nice thing that is called discrete event simulation. And you can get very easily, you can get from matrix analytic method to this discrete event simulation, because each transition in this Markov chain, actually it is an event. So that means that if you go from one to the next point, etc., that would be considered events in this discrete event simulation system. So there is interconnection between these two, between these two levels, let's say. So the event usually is, as Ryan told already, this is kind of a timer. These are all the timers. So we start the timers, and when one of them expires, that means that it becomes zero, we call this an event. And usually the nice point behind these things is that in between events, everything behaves in a very strict way. We know how it behaves. So it's some sort of piecewise deterministic Markov process or whatever. But practically, that means that usually, let's say you have like this, you have this virtual waiting time. Yeah? So then you have an event. In between events, nothing happens. It only decreases with 45 degrees, yeah? Usually. Then you have, let's say, arrival, then the waiting time becomes bigger. Then again, you have decrease. Between events, it behaves in a very predictable way. Just a linear decrease. That is the case. But at the event, we can get some... the discrete component, what is it? It is a state. It is a state of the system. So this is the timer, and this is the state. When one of them rings, we do some transition. That means we have some state transition of this time. And then, in between these timers, in between events, we have no transitions. What does it mean? That practically we come from, let's say, simulating at each point, we simulate the system state only at event points. And in between events, we know what happens. So we need to know time between events, and we need to know the state at each event. That's all. And then we are done, we can do the simulation. And the next, by doing so, we can get the approximation of the performance measures. It's very simple. So you get this, at these event points, you get this probability, let's say, of being at some specific state. Then you just multiply it by the time between events, and then you divide it by the whole simulation time. That's just kind of time average. Time averaging of the system. So we get some performance measure. And in some cases, we can even do some confidence estimation. So just this is a point estimator, of course, so you can get just one point. You say approximately the average response time of the system will be 1.5 seconds. But approximately doesn't mean anything. It's good to have some confidence interval. In between what and what, you guarantee that the response time will be. In this case, you need some more complicated things. And this is the regenerative theory where it comes to our help. So it can give us the confidence estimate of this thing. So the natural thing behind the discrete event simulation means that with this discrete event simulator, you can introduce these interesting things like artificial regeneration. I will not go into details because it needs a lot of time, but still that means that you are trying to put some trap for discrete component. If it enters some specific state, you can see what happens with the continuous component. And if it also gets into some interesting state, let's say it becomes exponential, then you say, okay, now it's the regeneration point. And in between regeneration points, you are doing this averaging, and then using some specific central limit theorem result of this type, you get this estimate for this quantity, but in terms of confidence interval. So, some ideas about the technical model. What can we do? The third level, the lowest level, that is more close to applications. We can try to mimic the behavior of a larger device by some smaller device. Let's say we want to simulate a supercomputer which is down below there. We can take a laptop. Okay, laptop is very flexible, it has multiple cores. The same characteristics like a supercomputer. We cannot experiment on this, but we can do like this. And also it has Linux inside. We can do some experimenting with some policies which are related to energy efficiency, let's say. So we can use some workload generators that would help us to get some specific characteristics of the input that are flexible, and that we can manage with them, and then experiment and see what is the outcome. And we can also use some simplified systems, let's say some client-server dummy applications that are doing this chatting, communicating in between, just to mimic the behavior of a large web server with some clients. So, but our goal is to keep the key features. We are focusing on some specific feature of this system. So I will show the examples. Now we'll go faster. Okay. So, first example is related to this result that I showed, the matrix analytic matrix. So it's 2x2 system. It is a very system, a very simple Internet of Things device. The key feature is that it has only some small battery. It has to save energy. By this reason, it's working only at some specific points. It doesn't have a clock, or it stops its clock, usually, to save some energy. That means that it can only, like in this Markov decision case, yeah, you can only act at arrival or at departure. You cannot act in between. So at arrival, you have to decide, at departure, you have to decide. What we are trying to introduce here is that it has two modes, the working, the high speed and low speed. But energy consumption, of course, at high speed is higher, at low speed is lower. And it is doing switching the speeds at arrival and departure. So then we model it as a QPD process. In this case, y of t is the speed. So it's either high or low. So then you get this performance, and this is also the energy that we are wasting per minute time on average. Next one. So we get this, all these matrices. You can see that A0 and A2 are full rank matrices, in fact. But still, since we have this result, we can obtain explicitly the solution for the stationary probability. Next one, please. So here are the solutions. Actually, the R matrix is expressed in terms of this A2, A0, and A1 matrices. And if we can even compare it with a system which doesn't manage it energy. So this is how the simulation model looks like, of the same system, the Internet of Things device. So we have the analytical model, now we have the simulation model. This is just, you can see at these formulas, they're not very nice, but still, this is one-step recursions. This is the timers, kind of time events approaches. Then something is happening during the event, so either arrival or departure, and we see also some switching of the modes. So this is the speed at the next step, which is related to some levels. Let's say in this case it's some sort of hysteretic control. In this case it's hysteretic, but in this case he's doing some interesting things. The system is flipping a coin. It throws a coin and says, okay, at what speed should I work? At higher or low? An interesting thing is that this just flipping a coin thus manages this energy efficiency. So we can save some energy by just flipping a coin at arrival and departure. That's something counterintuitive. Next one, please. And the technical model was a Linux laptop, in fact, that one. So we were thinking of it like a kind of model of IoT node. We had some Apache web server installed in that, and we used a TCP backlog, and that was our problem, in fact, to show the number of the queue. Next one, please. And here are these validation results. You can see one severe problem. The probability of zero is a bit larger than technical. So green is simulation, black is theoretical, and red is technical model. So all the three models here. Except this problem, they nearly coincide. The problem with this is that this TCP backlog doesn't manage to do it very fast. It doesn't capture the size of the queue. It does it in some specific way. So time to time, the real size is one, but it thinks that it's zero. So that's just one technical problem. And of course, I wanted to show it. Of course, I could, put this red cross as something here to convince you that it's very nice. But I wanted to show it just to convince you that you should always try to validate. And if you have these validation problems, maybe you should think of it. Maybe you should have to change your tools. In this case, we changed the tools. We are doing some experiments. No, I'll show you. Next one, please. So second one is a supercomputer. That was a small example. In this case, it's a huge one. Yeah? So the key feature of a supercomputer, it's a multiple machine. But one customer can take up to the whole machine, or maybe part of it. Next one. So this is how it looks like. So the first customer has taken only one CPU, the second customer occupies these two. There is a problem, the third one came here, but he cannot take these two servers because they need to be started at once. He needs all the three. And this is the wasted time. So this is, we waste this work. We could use it for some, but this one already departed, but this cannot start. That means that this that kind of severe problem in the model. Next one, please. So, we managed to find some stability criterion for this model, which looks not very nice, but still it's easily computed.
Yeah. See, this problem arises when there's some specific type of orchestrate process for the SMR SMR. Is it all right?
So this is a feature of the model, not a specific customer, but I mean, they are served on the first come first serve basis. So it's classical discipline, but still, this is, means that the discipline is not conserved. So the work is not conserved. If you have idle servers, you should not be losing the work, but here you are losing it. This is already present, but he cannot start. So the next one, please. So we managed to find the stability criterion for that using this quasi-birthday process, actually. And the next one, and this is kind of a equivalent representation, which motivates the students to study the combinatorics, because this is some discrete convolution things like that. So, next one, please. The simulation model looks pretty much the same like in previous case. So it's also a discrete event simulation. You get these events, which are arrivals, departures, and in this case, we are also experimenting with switching the speed of the supercomputer. So you can also save energy at the supercomputer by lowering the speed. And that is where you can say, okay, even in this case, one technical model, let's say that laptop, fits many technical examples. So it can be considered like IoT node, it can also be considered like supercomputer. In both cases, the same technical model may work. Next one, please. So again, event approaches, arrivals, departures, and probably switching the speed. Next one. At arrival and departure, we have some switching the state of the system. We do this remaining work switching, and this is how the server speed looks like, but just it's hysteretic controller also. So when it is in between two levels, it doesn't switch, but when it crosses one level up or one level down, it has to switch the speed. Next one. And this is how the performance measures looks in terms of this discrete event simulation. Again, you can get some idea that it's, at least it is computable. It doesn't look very nice, but it's computable. So once you get the trace, you get the run, you can compute all these things. So, but here we have to do the numerics, because we are at the second level. The next one. And the technical model was also that, but maybe that's not that one in this case, but still. So here we can also get some validation results. In this case, this is validation of simulation model across the technical model. And we can see that, they fit nicely. Because we have no theoretical model in this case, unfortunately. The theoretical model is very hard. We do not have it. Only simulation and technical. And the third example is the trial queue. I will try to do faster. So The trial queues were already announced today. Next one. So this was kind of a two-way retrial queue with constant retrial rate, an interesting concept where an operator at the call center, he's receiving some calls but can also get some outgoing calls. So when the operator is idle, she can ring you and say, okay, I come from the bank, I want to introduce you our very nice credit card, you are convinced to buy it. So that's all they are doing. So these are the incoming rates, outgoing rates, and also we get the retrial rates, which are related to the customers who are in orbit, and they are trying to call you back again. Next one, please. So here, we have the stationary performance measures. Next one. This is the idle probability, the busy probability, and some extra. There, you have the analytical results. Okay, we have analytics, that's good. The next one we have, okay, so we can skip the proof. So just as an example how it looks like, this is a cumulative proof. They arrived work, this is yet unserved, this is being served, this is who already departed from the system. This is a cumulative process. So from point zero to time t. So all the work that arrived from point zero to time t. And we get these limits. And in this case, we can see that at least some of them diminish. This diminishes when we divide by t. There is no work that stays at the system forever. It, time to time, it leaves the system. And here, as a limit, we get the probability of being busy. And we get this nice equation that the probability of being busy is related to rho, etc. Next. So a bit more complicated model, but in case of MM1 type, we can get even some more extra performance measures. Next one. So in this case, we can also get the QBD model, but the nice feature about it is A2 is of rank 1. And that makes us have this explicit solution. And we really made it, thank you. So, we can also obtain this explicit solution. Next one. And that's how the R looks like. So it is obtained explicitly, the P0 is obtained explicitly, and then we can get this P00, which is the probability of regeneration in the system. Right? Because the P00 means that no one is present. Next one. It's related to stability. But, so at the usually P0, obtaining P0 is a problem. But in this case, we are doing some trick. So we are trying to obtain not P0, but Z0, which is related to the server state. Not the whole system state, but to the server state. And then we arrive at this specific, also it's linear equation. You can get a solution, but it doesn't need, you do not need to do the matrix inversion when doing this solution. But also the nice thing is that Z0 you can obtain by the generative approach. So this is the interconnection between these two methods. So in matrix analytic methods, pure matrix analytic methods, you are studying the matrix R, you obtain the R, then you have to find V0, and then you've done it. You have done, you find everything. But in this case, we are trying to combine these approaches. So you obtain R, let's say, by some numerics or by explicit expression. In this case, it was explicit, yeah? And then you obtain the Z0, these, as a limit of these cumulative processes, so as a regenerative limit. In this case, these you can obtain just by doing this balanced type of quotients, like this V of t divided by t, which converges to something, etc. Then you get P0, which is equal to rho, P0 equal to rho, and P0 to 1 minus rho, etc. And by these type of things, you obtain this. And that means that this is some sort of combination. Oh, it's the last one. So it was the idea behind this was to show you that even in some cases, the theoretical methods that are quite far away from each other, the matrix analytic method and the regenerative method, they can contribute to get some extra, like to get some synergy effect, let's say, So you are using one method, but then at some specific point you do the switch and you switch to regenerative, which is easier to obtain this Z0 investment. Yeah? And then you get the solution in a more smart way. So thank you for the attention. I think we can shift if you have any questions, we can make the discussions outside so that they have a bit more time for lunch. Yeah. Thank you. So the next, I think we'll start at 3 p.m. The next session will be started at 3 p.m. It's okay. Huh? I think 5 will be fine.